Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people, who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now I want to remind you, although you once fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved a people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. And the angels, who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desires, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. Yet in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Woe to them, for they walk in the way of Cain, and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error, and perished in Korah's rebellion. These are hidden reefs at your love feasts, as they feast with you without fear. Shepherds feeding themselves, waterless clouds swept along by winds, fruitless trees in late autumn twice dead uprooted, wild waves of the sea casting up the foam of their own shame, wandering stars for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. It was also about these that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his holy ones, to execute judgment on all and to convict all the ungodly of all their deeds of ungodliness, that they have committed in such an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loud-mouthed boasters, showing favoritism to gain advantage." But you must remember, beloved, the predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. They said to you, "In the last time, there will be scoffers, following their own ungodly passions. It is these who cause divisions, worldly people devoid of the Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourself up in the most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourself in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forever. Amen."
Somebody was reminding me that we pushed ahead and got through verse 5 last week. Is that true? I think we did. Now I want to remind you, although you once fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved a people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who didn't believe. And what we were talking about was that it's real easy to think of God in the Old Testament and God doing everything, but it was really Jesus. Jesus was his agent, as it were, the Son of God. Still God, fully God, but the Son of God. And he was the one who saved the people out of the land of Egypt. So this week, we're going to talk about verse 6 and hopefully get through verse 8. "And the angels who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day." All right. So let's just summarize verse 5 again. We basically learned that Jesus is better than saying the Lord only because there's new manuscript evidence that shows that to be the way it was in the early church. It's a little more specific, and it tells you something very, very important about Jesus. He's not just what a lot of people paint him as, a picture of this precious moments type Jesus. He's really God. We also learned Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is God. That's easy and obvious. Jesus was the destroyer. He was the one who destroyed those who didn't believe, which is very harsh sounding, right? When was that? When was that point at which they didn't believe and they were destroyed? Because it says afterwards he destroyed those who did not believe.
Is that when they were still in bondage and the angel killed all the firstborn?
I don't think so. I think this is speaking about after they've been saved. After they've, yeah, during the golden calf, and then that process of them rejecting, you know, we'll do whatever you say, Lord, and then they don't. We'll do whatever you say, Lord, and then they don't. We'll do whatever you say, Lord, and then they don't. And God was patient. But how many of them made it to the promised land?
Two.
Two. Joshua and Caleb. So that's really what that's referring to, is that, you know, that point in time at which judgment came upon them. And he commanded to preach to the people and testify that he is the one appointed by God to judge the living and the dead. So to think of Jesus in this way, as a judge, isn't wrong. Because Jesus himself commanded us to preach about him in that way, that he is the judge. He is the one who will come to judge the living and the dead. What will happen at Jesus' second coming, and what should we be doing until then? Well, 2 Timothy told us, I charge you, in the presence of God Christ, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. We often kind of just glance through some of this stuff. The purpose of preaching the word, and teaching for that matter, is that the word itself, not the preacher, not the teacher, the word itself rebukes people, reproves people, but it also exhorts people unto good works with complete patience and teaching. There's this sense of we want to rush things sometimes. We want somebody to get the point now, especially if you're having an argument on Facebook or something like that. It's like they said something that was unbiblical, and I'm going to make sure that they admit it, you know. Well, just share with them the truth. Share with them the Word of God, and let the Holy Spirit deal with that. With complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. When is that time? When people will not endure sound teaching?
Now.
Since the cross, really. Since before that. But having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. What would that look like, accumulating a teacher to suit your own passion? Not sure we ever stop and think about it, but it's like, I want my pastor to be preaching about this. So, and he's not. So we're going to get rid of that pastor.
Or go find another.
And go find another pastor who will listen to us or me, and he'll teach or preach about this. Well, if it's biblical, if you have a pastor who's preaching non-biblical stuff, certainly replace him with somebody who's going to teach and preach biblical stuff. But sometimes people will get to the point where they don't really want to hear the truth of the word every Sunday. They want to hear other stuff. And some of that other stuff is what? Well, I'd rather you preached on how to balance my checkbook. I'd rather you preached on how to have a good marriage. Now, there's nothing wrong with that because God is pro-marriage. But if you do a 12-part sermon series and you bring a bed onto the stage and you and your wife sleep on the roof of the church, You're kind of going to an extreme. That's why the Lutheran Church has always had the lectionary, and they've always had the church years, where that focuses our attention on what we should be learning at that point in time, and it's happening in lots of churches. And it's kind of also a little curb for the pastor to say, you don't really want to go over there and preach about that because you got to preach within these texts this week.
The truth is, and I'm probably not different than most pastors, I want my people to love me. I want them to like me. I want them to think I'm smart and witty. And if I were given free rein, the liturgy on Sunday morning would be all about Larry Peters. I would be the MC. I would do my monologue. I would make sure there was no dry eye in the house. I would make sure that people were laughing. And when they got in their car on their way home, they would say, boy, that is really one talented guy. I love our pastor. He is so smart. He is so funny. That's who I am. Thank God that there is a liturgy there to restrain that star that is seeking the limelight and the spotlight. It is Christ that people need to be talking about when they walk out the door on Sunday morning. They need to hear the word. They need to receive the supper. They need to experience the fellowship life of God's people gathered in that place. They need to receive the gifts, to celebrate the gifts, to respond to the gifts with joy and praise and thanksgiving. And that's what their witness before the world will display and will draw people in.
And many will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. He's talking to Timothy, a pastor. Pastors and Christians alike are called to be sober-minded, endure suffering, and do the work. This is specifically to pastors in terms of the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry as a pastor, young Timothy. So, pastors suffer for the sake of the gospel. Preaching the word is not going to always be popular, and there's going to be some suffering that's going to be involved. Or you can preach what people want to hear, and itch their ears, and they will love you, and you won't suffer. That's an option, not a good one. So, verse 6, and the angels who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day. Which angels are being spoken of here?
Fallen.
Yeah, we call them the fallen angels. Right? Not all angels, just these angels, the angels who were kept this way. What does it mean they left their proper dwelling place? They got bored with heaven? Nah, God's just a little too much of a taskmaster. Let's get out of here. Does it mean that they chose to leave?
I have abandoned.
Abandoned? Okay.
They made the decision. They had free will at the time. Chose to disobey.
Okay.
And that free will was taken away? Is that right? Where do we know that from?
Do angels have free will? Do we have free will? That's a whole other Bible study. I was just talking to somebody about that yesterday. They left their proper dwelling place. It says in 2 Peter, for if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell.
Is it in
there? Sorry.
Well, he was just talking about the angels locked in. They've had their judgment.
Yeah, they're locked. They can no longer repent. That's
just wondering where the Bible that speaks to that their free will was taken away.
Well, these verses may help us with that. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell, did the angels themselves voluntarily leave heaven? They were cast out. God cast them out.
Like Adam and Eve.
Like Adam and Eve, exactly. And then again in Revelation, and he seized the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years and threw him into the pit and shut it and sealed it over him so that he might not deceive the nations any longer until the 1,000 years are ended. So God seized the dragon. Jesus seized the dragon. if you think about it in terms of Jesus doing the work, you can kind of place where it happened in history. And he bound him for 1,000 years. So we did a whole study on Revelation, but anybody know when 1,000 years is?
Now.
It's now. It's not a literal 1,000 years. It's the time from Jesus' crucifixion and death and resurrection and ascension until the end. It's that whole period of time. It's representative of that whole period of time. So, the Satan, who had freedom before that, right, in a manner of speaking, although he did kind of talk to God sometimes, right? Hey, what about Job? And God's like, yeah, you can do whatever you want to Job, you just can't kill him.
So where are these fallen angels now?
They're in this pit. He threw the devil and Satan and really all his angels into this abyss, into this pit, and shut it and sealed it over them. Well, that's not literal necessarily either. There isn't a place we're looking for. And some people in the ancient days had a place that they considered to be this place, because they went into this cave and they found a hole, and the hole was bottomless, and they assumed that that was the abode of which all these devils and demons and angels were cast into.
Well, since nothing can go through the black hole, maybe there's something on the other side of the black hole that's, you know.
What it really is trying to point us to is that God's in control, and it's shut in and it's sealed, and he has not able to deceive the nation. It doesn't mean that there's no evil in the world. It doesn't mean that Satan doesn't have any influence in the world, but he's bound with these chains, right? Because it even says up here that these angels were kept in eternal chains. And if you study on that a little bit, you'll discover that it means they're kind of on a short leash. They can do some messing with the world, but they don't have free reign. They never really have. God's always been in control.
So is the devil omnipresent?
No. The devil is not God. God is the only one that's omnipresent. Which is an interesting thing to think about, isn't it, Rudy? If the devil's not omnipresent, is he messing with you at the same time he's messing with me? No. But he has minions that are out there, and he just has the fact that we live in a fallen world, and all he has to do is create environments where it's fun to sin.
So Chris, in chapter 12 in Revelation, when it talks about that he threw Satan and the demons to earth, how does that link up with the pits?
Well, they left their abode. They left their, they were heavenly creatures.
Right.
They're no longer in heaven.
Well, going to Dell's question.
Right. They're not in the black hole. Well, they were cast here, and this is kind of now, there's this, Scripture speaks of this dominion, right? We have this battle against the dominions of darkness, and it's in our reality. But it's a spiritual battle, right? So there's this sense that these angels had no power, these fallen angels, until, and maybe not until they were cast down. And now that they're here, they're not in heaven anymore. They can't go back to heaven anymore. But they can, on their short chains, mess with us.
But
I didn't bring my Bible with me.
I could read that.
Yeah, please do, because I didn't read my Bible. I didn't bring my Bible.
Revelation 12, starting at verse 7. And there's a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to earth, and his angels with him. And then later in verse 12, it says, "Woe to the earth and sea, because the devil has gone down to you, is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short."
Right.
And then the verses in, Peter, it talks about the devil is prowling like a
prowls
lion.
Around like
it
a lion.
Makes it sound like he and his angels are here.
Yeah, in a manner of speaking. The thing about Revelation is that it's not a linear book, so we don't look at chapter 12 and say that came eight chapters before chapter 20. it's cyclical, and it kind of tells the same story over and over again from different camera angles, so to speak. So this here in 20 is kind of a different take on the same thing that's going on in 12. So you have to add all those up and see what's going on. But yeah, they were cast down here. And why? Don't know, right? Why not just destroy them? Although God does say that certain things happen to test our faith.
The footnote says, before they had their specific locations and responsibilities. What responsibilities or locations?
Is that from Revelation? Or from,
no, from Jude.
Okay, read the whole footnote.
I guess six. God had assigned different areas of responsibility and authority to each of the angels, according to Deuteronomy, where the various princes may be angels assigned to various nations. Some of the angels refused to maintain their assignments and thus became the devil and his angels. Angels apparently were assigned specific locations as well as responsibilities. Some assumed that they left the heavenly realm and came to earth.
Well, it's clear that God will command his angels on our behalf. So they have tasks. The angels have, they're not just sitting up in heaven praising God, though they're doing that. They also have tasks that they are given. Many of us in entertaining strangers have entertained angels unaware, as Scripture says. But we really shouldn't be angel hunting. We shouldn't be out there wondering if this person is an angel or that person is an angel, that kind of thing. I think what exactly the roles of angels are, we don't terribly know, because that was in the unfallen world. That was in, and we don't know how long that period of time was, I'm thinking. So once, you know, at what point were the angels cast down? My understanding from studying Revelation was that the angels had their heavenly dwelling until Christ. They still had access to the heavenlies, as it were, until the crucifixion of Christ. And at that point, when it talks about stars being cast down and stuff like that, it's Christ winning the victory and the angels being kicked out, the bad angels being kicked out. So, kind of interesting to think about that. In the Old Testament, Satan was coming and going, and now, from Christ forward, he's just here. He doesn't have that access to heaven anymore. And neither do his demons. But they're everywhere. Don't know how many of them there are. There's a third of whatever existed before that, roughly, right? Don't know how many there are. Don't know exactly where they are. Again, we shouldn't be angel hunting. Whether they're good angels or bad angels. Some people are so into trying to cast out demons that they're looking for demons everywhere. And some people are so wanting to give God credit, which is a great thing to do, that they're finding angels everywhere. None of those are like, you know, I would say looking for demons is probably not a good plan, but looking for angels, that wouldn't be the worst thing in the world, but it just kind of distracts you from what you're supposed to be doing, right? One of you guys could be an angel. I think some of the nurses at the hospital. Yeah, what do we call nurses at the hospital? We call them angels of mercy. Well, we used to. And I think most of the nurses at Texas Children's are angels of mercy, because they just have an amazing gift for caring for these little ones. Anyway, we need to move forward because this is building on itself here, and we don't want to stall out too bad. And even though it says they're not allowed to deceive the nations any longer, that's not properly understood. Hey, Jim. That's in the way they used to. They're not allowed to deceive the nations the way they used to. They're more restricted until the very end when they are released for a short time. We're in the Great Tribulation, but there's a really great, at the very end where it just gets miserable. And who knows, when we were studying Revelation, we basically came to the conclusion that it's not 7 years and it's not a long period of time. It's just a one last intense, because God releases them to judge them. The reason that the angels are released at the end from this restriction and this pit and all this kind of language, it's not literal. They're just released so God can judge them permanently. Finally. Has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness. What does that mean? What does kept them in eternal chains? Well, in the second part of that verse from 2 Peter, where it said, for if God did not spare angels when they sinned, angels sinned? Well, yeah, they're not God. But cast them into hell and committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment. That's 2 Peter, and that sounds an awful lot like Jude, which is why people compare the two letters. The language is very similar. Kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day, committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hands the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. Who is this angel that came down in Revelation 20, verse 1, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit where Satan was about to be cast? Who is this angel here? Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. Jesus is often referred to as the angel of God. So this is Jesus coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a chain.
That just says an angel.
Right.
The angel. Sometimes it says the angel.
Sometimes it says the. But a lot of times it's referring to, usually it says the archangel Michael or Gabriel. It doesn't usually just say an angel or the angel. So what's he about to do? Why does he have this great chain that he came down? He has a key? All symbolism in Revelation, right? He has a key to a bottomless pit, symbolism, and a great chain, symbolism. When you have a key, what are you? You have the ability to
lock. You're the janitor.
You're the janitor, yeah. You have the ability.
Cleaning up the mess.
Or dental.
You have the ability to lock or unlock something, right? You can lock your front door, you can unlock your front door. You can lock the strong box, you can unlock the strong box. You can start your car or not start your car.
So how do you chain a spirit?
How does God chain a spirit?
That's a good question.
That's a very good question. It's a great chain. Why is it a great chain?
Maybe it means strong or big or something.
It means God's chain.
Chain is a limit.
Yeah. It's
dog.
It's like an electric wire put around your yard, in a sense. It limits the place your dog's going to go. It's a means of expressing in figurative terms that God's in control and that Satan and his demons, angels, fallen angels, are going to have limited abilities.
My Bible says a heavy chain.
Heavy chain. It would be.
I've got everlasting chain.
Everlasting chain. Okay.
Boy.
So when is this great day of judgment that's being spoken of in this passage, in verse 6? Until the judgment of the great day. When is that great day?
The day of our Lord.
Day of our Lord. It is specifically talking about the last day and the second advent. He will come again, as the creed says, to judge the living and the dead. And the false teaching. But by the same word, the heavens and the earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. So, why isn't God just fixing everything right now? Well, he's got a plan. And that plan involves a big old reset button, so to speak. We're being stored up. The heavens and the earth that now exist, the stars, the universe, our planet, ourselves, whatever. It's all being stored up for fire. What does that mean? It means on the day of judgment, something serious is going to happen. Being kept until the day of judgment and the destruction of the ungodly. Now, what do your other translations say there? Does it say destruction of the ungodly?
Mine does.
I'm sorry, is it Peter, Jude?
It's 2 Peter 3:7. I'm only asking because I want to go down a rabbit trail for a minute.
By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly.
Destruction, yeah. That's why you can't just go to one place and look at something, because this is a passage that people who believe in annihilationism, if you've ever heard that word, they'll go, well, see, it says right there, the ungodly are going to be destroyed. Well, you have to go to other places to talk about the eternal fire. Why would the fire be eternal if they're utterly destroyed? It would only have to exist for a short period of time. But we're stored up for this eternal fire, this fire. Something's going to happen in the last day. Who are these ungodly? Well, some of these ungodly are the people being spoken of here in Jude, these people that we're about to talk about. People who don't believe in God and people who pervert the word of God. The one who rejects me and does not receive my words has a judge. The word that I have spoken will judge him on the last day. Now that word should probably be capitalized in the W. But it also speaks to the power of God's word. Remember we talked earlier about the preaching of the word and what it does? It reproves, it rebukes, it exhorts. It does all these things with great patience, right? God could just fix it all right now, but he's doing it with great patience. So the one who rejects me, Christ, and does not receive my words has a judge. You could say, those who don't receive the word of God, that would rather have their ears itched rather than receive sound teaching, they have to be careful. We can't tell them that they're one of these ungodly, necessarily. But, boy, you've got to be careful. You have to receive the word. And the word is, before anything else, the gospel, that Jesus is the Christ. So Jesus is saying, the one who rejects me and does not receive my words has a judge. Well, who is that judge, Jesus? Well, the judge is the word that I have spoken. That's a pretty powerful word, if it can judge. And it'll judge him on the last day. What did you do with me? Well, I believed. Okay. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. God gives you the ability to believe. Do you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? If you don't receive the words of God, and then there are people out there who mess with it, and that's what these false teachers love to do. They love to kind of get it a little bit right and then kind of itch people's ears and whatever and take it off in another direction.
Well, Chris,
yeah.
A second ago you said something about God giving people the ability to receive the word. Was that what you said?
I said the ability to believe.
The ability to believe.
When you get, when you receive the gift of faith, you therefore believe the word of God.
Right.
Everybody has the ability to receive the word because the word is preached to all nations.
Well, they hear it externally.
Right. But not everybody has the ability to receive the word to believe. They're given that ability to believe.
Right. God works faith when and where he will.
Right.
My question is, if we say that and we believe it, God works faith when and where he wills. What does the Bible say about what he wills? It says he wills that all men be saved.
He would have all men to be saved.
He said that in 2 Peter. Yeah. He says, the very reason God does not judge the world right now is so that all men will be saved, so that all will have opportunity to repent and be saved. says,
which verse, chapter?
2 Peter 3:8, very next verse.
Yeah.
Do not forget one thing, my dear friends. There's no difference in the Lord's sight between one day and 1,000 years. To him, the two are the same.
Right.
The Lord is not slow to do what he has promised, as some think. Instead, he is patient with you, because he does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants all to turn away from their sins.
That's his.
Plus, 1 Timothy.
That's his desire, right?
God wants all men to be saved.
Or God would have all men to be saved, and it's a matter of, is it God's will to save all people, and therefore we believe in universalism? But then we can't explain why some people don't believe and some people are damned and go to hell and are judged, unless that's where you start getting into free will, and that's where free will kicks in. You don't have the free will to be given the gospel. You wouldn't want it. You wouldn't choose it. But once somebody gives it to you, you have the free will to reject it.
Well, personally, something I struggle with is the Lutheran Church says you cannot believe unless God gives you faith. I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. It says that right in the Catechism. It also, you know, we teach that God works faith when and where he wills. Mm-hmm. Well, then, if God wants all men to be saved, and we cannot believe unless he acts, then why do some believe, why do some not? Because...
Parable of the seed.
Yes, I know that, but my point is, it's not that some soil is more deserving.
No, no soil is deserving. No soil is deserving. Right? Is my soil deserving or your soil deserving? Or no. None of the soil is deserving. God is, when the first soil comes, when God is casting the seed out, it's a broadcast spreader. He's not saying, I'm going to just plant it in these tufts here at Trinity Lutheran Church, or I'm going to plant it in these tufts over there. He's broadcasting it. He wants it broadcast. That's the whole point of the gospel, right? Go into all the world and proclaim the good news. Spread the seed of the gospel everywhere you go.
Right, I understand that. But it's almost like, if I can make an analogy, you know how they have these genetically engineered seeds? You know, like the kind that you plant one time, it grows a crop, and then you can't save back some of the seed and plant it again. They've engineered so that it won't work, because you have to keep buying the seed from Monsanto or whoever it is. Well, the word is the seed. Everybody hears the word, but not everyone believes it. For them to believe it, the Holy Spirit has to act through the word and create faith in that person's heart. And sometimes he does, and sometimes he doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Election, predestination, not what this particular lesson is about.
Well, I know that, but we're talking about people being judged because they reject the word of God.
Well, we're talking about the ungodly false teachers, particularly.
I agree, but they also heard the word, and they also are, according to the scripture, within God's desired will to be saved. So, a thing I struggle with, and I do not have a solution, is if God has his word externally preached to people, and then for whatever reason does not work faith in their heart through that word, and then condemns them for it, that's hard to understand as being fair. And maybe that's just me being human. But
it's us trying to figure out something sometimes that the scripture's not clearly as clear about as we would like, so we struggle to try and figure it out. Why in the Old Testament did God appear to only be concerned about a small group of wandering people and not be concerned at all about what would probably be considered 98% of the rest of the world? Because the Hebrews weren't that large of a nation, right? They became a great nation, but so okay, God, you've chosen these people. Does that mean you've rejected these people? They're beyond salvation? That wasn't what he was doing. He never told the Jews, I'm giving you this, put it in a box and keep it. Although they did. I mean, they put
some
it,
of them, yeah.
You know, even from the Old Testament days, they were to be of influence. They were to take Yahweh with them wherever they went. You know,
sure.
And they refused to do it. They got all, you know, me about it.
Well, all I'm saying is, it seems to me that if I had to choose between Calvinism and Universalism.
And there was no Lutheranism to choose.
Yeah, it would definitely be Universalism, because that is more compatible with the picture of God that the Bible tells.
Right, God is
Calvinism one. Basically says, the reason some people are saved is God doesn't want them to be.
Right.
He only cares about some people.
Double predestination.
So
God has predestined some to be saved and predestined others to be damned. And you could point to a scripture. It's a passage that easily could be pointed to and say, see, God prepared some people for condemnation in advance because of how, if you read it a certain way.
You're thinking of Romans where he talks about the vessels of destruction.
Yeah, the vessels of destruction. And it's like, well, okay, right there, God has some people as vessels of glory. Some people are vessels of glory and some people are vessels of destruction. Why? Well, we're getting into a study we probably should do, which is the study of election and predestination. You want to simplify election? Do you believe? You're one of the elect.
Or if there's a flicker of flame, he won't put it out.
Yeah. There is this sense, though, of people running away from God, people that reject God. These angels rejected God. They were cast out. They had a little bit harsher treatment, it sounds like, right? We reject God, and God chases us down, in a manner of speaking. He's like, keep giving them the gospel, keep giving them the gospel, and they'll come back, you know, kind of attitude. With angels, it seems like, although it was a long period of time, because they weren't cast out.
There was no plan of salvation.
There's no plan of salvation for the angels. Once they're
that we know
judged, they are cast out, and they are done, as far as we can tell from Scripture.
We're, yeah. You know. Maybe there was eons ago, and we just don't know.
So, but thankfully, even these false teachers in the Book of Jude, God's probably trying to get to them. He's probably trying to say, stop teaching false gospel. Stop teaching false doctrine. Return to the truth. And you people that I'm writing this letter to have to be involved in making sure that, you know, it's part of your life, you know, as a congregation. So, are you going to know the word? Are you going to make sure that your preachers preach the word? Are you going to make sure that your teachers teach the word? Honestly, if you sit through a Bible class, and I've done this, we did it in the Martin Luther study, but I mean, as a general rule, if you're not pulling up Scripture and discussing Scripture and letting Scripture talk to you and help you interpret itself, it's not sort of technically a Bible study. It could be like, well, you need to balance your checkbook because God said lots about money in the Bible. Okay, well, let's do a Bible study, you know? That's what Bible studies are supposed to be about. Okay, verse 7. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desire, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. This is not going well. We got three examples going on here. What was Sodom and Gomorrah's sin? Well, obviously sexual immorality and pursuing unnatural desires. We don't really need to talk about that, right? Unnatural desires, Sodom and Gomorrah. A lot of people have actually gone into this text and tried to prove that God's not talking about sodomy, why we call it sodomy in the first place. God's not talking about men having sex with men. He's talking about something else. They didn't call those men out to have men having sex with them. No, it's like they're just trying to justify their agenda by reinterpreting. That's false teaching. Just let the text say what it says, right? Well, how did Sodom and Gomorrah serve as an example? They underwent this punishment of eternal fire.
Well, here's the thing with that. It says they underwent the punishment of eternal fire, but the fire that destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah did not burn eternally.
Right.
So, if you're an annihilationist,
well,
you could say there's a case of eternal fire where it's not literally eternal.
Well,
in other words, the judgment is eternal, but the fire itself is not. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
In other words, the fire and brimstone rain down, destroy Sodomore, the fire went out after 2 weeks.
The judgment was eternal.
Yeah, that sentence is not the same as the Bible sentence. The Bible doesn't say that the people in Sodom and Gomorrah, although they may have,
I should have
suffered eternal fire. It says they served as an example of those who suffered the punishment of eternal fire.
Well, this is from the ESV.
I'll bet you this is a rendering. Yeah, this is probably a... Well, it's just like the phrase about unnatural desire. I know I read in a footnote that said literally it means going after strange flesh.
Yes.
I think that's what it says in the King James. Yeah. Sometimes King James gets things
it's interesting. Right.
Yeah. And it's easy to remember.
Well, here's another question, Chris.
Oh, good.
Maybe I'll already talk about this before I got here, but I know this verse, well, here's what it says in today's English version. This is my mother's, by the way. It says, "Remember Sodom and Gomorrah and the nearby towns whose people acted as those angels did and indulged in sexual immorality and perversion." So, in other words, the whole idea that,
is that a footnote?
The angels that Jude is talking about were the angels who slept with human women.
Oh, the Nephilim and the...
The Nephilim, Genesis 6.
All that kind of stuff. I don't know. I'd have to really look into that before I could render any kind of a... Because the implication there is that angels are physical enough beings to have physical relations with people.
Yeah, I don't know if they are.
We assume that they're spirit beings. But also, then, they say many have entertained angels unaware, and if you entertain them, they at least have to appear. Is that talking about real angels? It must be, right?
Yeah.
Well, have you ever read this, have you ever heard of this guy? His name is Michael Heiser.
No.
H-E-I-S-E-R. I stumbled on this guy a while back when I was looking something else up online. Apparently, this guy is a professor of Semitic languages somewhere. And he has a website called The Naked Bible. Well, apparently he is quite knowledgeable about biblical languages. And it's funny, he actually has written a book where he tries to... He is a Christian. I don't know what denomination. But he actually has written a book where he tries to reach out and minister to people who are caught up in UFO cults. Which sounds weird, but he's like, well, there are a lot of more people out there that are into that stuff than you'd think. And he argues the Nephilim and the whole thing. He says, this is what he says, and I'm not an expert, so what do I know? The usual way we interpret Genesis 6 in the sons of God, the daughters of men, is that's the Cainites and the Sethites, right? The godly and the ungodly intermarrying. His argument against that is threefold. Number one, he says no one before the 3rd century AD ever thought that. That when the people of the Christ time and before, the Second Temple Judaism, when they read Genesis 6, they always thought angels and women getting together. That was just, whether that was right or not, that was the universal understanding. Like the Book of Enoch, which we'll get into later because we're going to talk about that quote. He says, Enoch spells it right out and says, yes, there were angels who slept with mortal women and had children, those who believed. The second thing he says is, he argues that if you look at what the word Nephilim means, that the language and the trend, like he talks about the language, which I'm not knowledgeable about. The third thing he says is that, I can't remember what the third point is. But anyway, his argument is that's what this verse is talking about too. He references Jude, because he says this is an allusion to the same incident. What it's worth, which I don't really care. I don't really have a dog in them.
Yeah. And in terms of what the Book of Jude is trying to communicate,
it's just saying don't listen to false teachers.
That level of
judge like the evil angel.
That level of detail,
regardless of what they did.
Yeah. And you could go back and reread the Sodom and Gomorrah story, and then there it does say angels, and you know, send them out. You know, well, what do those angels want to do? You know.
Just like Ezekiel, there's that passage in Ezekiel talks about Sodom and Gomorrah and why they were judged. And
some people
try to milk that one and say, oh, well, it's not talking about sex.
Right, exactly. That's what I was talking about earlier. People
not
try
their only sin or whatever.
Mr. Rudy.
As an aside, if you go to the Holy Land, to the Dead Sea, past Masada and so on, there's a sign that says Sodom straight ahead. And they have a big salt mine fertilizer plant over there where they mine salt, fertilizer, whatever.
Interesting.
So I wonder.
So the ancient city, at least they think that's the site of the ancient city, and it still exists.
The name of, yeah, the name said Sodom. Mm-hmm. So you begin to wonder if all of a sudden God rained hailstone on them and everything turned into salt.
Everything turned into salt, yeah. So there's this passage I think Jim referenced from Matthew 25. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. This is the judgment, right? We're talking end of Matthew. It's like there's the sheep and the goats. There's those on the right and those on the left. And what does he say to the sheep? He says, come to me.
Enter into my kingdom.
Enter into my kingdom.
My father.
And what does he say to the goats?
Depart
from me. So at some point, it's real clear, there are those who are believers in the end and those who are unbelievers in the end. And those who are ungodly, unbelievers, false teachers would qualify if they don't repent of their false teaching and come to the truth. There's this place prepared for the devil and his angels, and that's where you go also. An eternal fire. Now, if it's eternal, again, why would annihilationism be a valid argument? If the fire is eternal, so would the punishment be. The punishment is often referred to as eternal punishment also. So
you could argue they were eternally destroyed.
Right, and I've heard this one guy, I think Ed somebody, whatever, online, argue that it's, they're destroyed and they will no longer exist, so it's eternal.
Well, Revelation 20 says they will be tormented day and night forever and ever.
He likes to ignore that verse.
What's the verse there again?
Oh, that's 10.
Revelation 20, verse 10.
2010. And then it links 2010, then links to 14, where the humans get thrown in the same lake.
Yeah.
It says the beast and the false prophet and the devil, they will be tormented day and night.
In a place.
It doesn't say all the ungodly.
Well, but here it says...
Verse 14. Well, the verse 14 later.
Oh, verse 14.
Then says in that same lake, the second death.
Yeah.
If your name is not in the book of life, you're thrown into the...
The eternal. The lake of fire, lake of sulfur. It's got all these names. It's an eternal place. Now, I want to remind you, although you fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved the people out of the land of Egypt, so Jesus is involved here, afterwards destroyed those who did not believe. And we learn that he is the one who does the judging of the living and the dead, right? And the angels who did not stay in their position of authority, they're kept in chains until the day of judgment. Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, likewise, serve as an example of this eternal fire, this eternal punishment, right? There's three things there. We have Egypt, and they were judged. We have the angels, and they were judged. And we have Sodom and Gomorrah, and they were judged. So it's an example of God's judgment. These three things are just driving home the point that God is a judge, and Jesus is the judge.
But I know the term in verse 6 where it says gloomy darkness.
Mm-hmm. That's
the Greek word is Tartarus. Which is, interestingly, the only place in the New Testament, I believe, where that word is used. It's also the word used in Greek mythology, where the giants who fought against Zeus were thrown into a pit in Hades to be kept under lock and key.
Titans?
What?
The Titans?
The Titans, the giants, yeah. And that, interestingly, fits well with the whole Genesis 6 thing saying, because there were giants in the earth in those days, right? Yeah. Oh, Michael Heiser also believes they really were giants.
The Nephilim, yeah, the whatever.
They weren't
tiny.
They weren't
people.
Like 20 feet tall, but they were like an NBA player.
Yeah, they were Goliath-sized.
Well, he also mentions when the Hebrews entered the Holy Land. Remember it says, when they entered the Holy Land, the spies went in and they said, we saw the
giants,
the Anakim and the Nephilim, and we were like grasshoppers to them. Mm-hmm. That they were really a race of really big people.
Right. And somebody who wants to really abuse Scripture will tell you, see, if you have milk and honey and grapes and things like that, then you will be that healthy and you'll be that big and tall. And let's write a book about it. Or you could have the Daniel plan. which somebody wrote a book about. There's somehow a dietary...
Oh, right. Drink water and eat vegetables, you'll be very healthy.
Yeah, the Daniel plan. Well, I don't think for somebody to preach on that for a month or two, whatever he did, that's just insane. You know why he preached on it for so long? Because he was selling books. I'm sorry. Again.
No, that's okay. You're right. We've got all kinds of books out there.
You just got it. Call it what it is.
I survived the four blood moons, and all I got was this lousy t-shirt.
I have one of those.
Yeah, I know. I'm talking about your t-shirt.
Am I wearing it?
No.
So, who are these people, these people, you know, that are kept? Yet in like manner, these people also. Who are these people? These people are...
So notice the comparison. Here, Jude is comparing these false teachers who've crept in among us, who've turned the grace of Christ into a license for sensuality. He's comparing them to, well, the people in Egypt who grumbled and didn't believe God, or the children of Israel in the wilderness who had been freed from Egypt, those, and they died in the wilderness. He's compared them to the fallen angels, and he's now compared them to Sodom and Gomorrah. These are not politically correct, flattering comparisons. I guarantee you, if I were to compare any of you to Sodom and Gomorrah, the church council would have words with me. But that's exactly who Jude is comparing these false teachers to. And there's a reason for that. Each and every one of these examples are people or groups who've undergone God's visible judgment for their rebellion against God.
Yeah. And that's what the point is. These false teachers are going to undergo the same thing. Unless they can repent. I mean, that's the whole thing when we talk about God being patient. Why is God patient? It's a repentance thing. He wants all people to repent and turn, as it were, be turned back to him. That's what he wants. And we're going to talk about verse 8 next week. Yet in like manner, these people, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh. There's the flesh again. Reject authority and blaspheme the glorious ones. So we'll talk about that. And we may, I don't know when we're going to get to Jim's favorite verse. Let us close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to gather around your word, to be about the study of that word, to be led by your Holy Spirit through the study of that word. We thank you for these men, their dedication to that task. We thank you for the great discussion that we had today. Lead and guide us, guard and protect us. Bring us back next week to continue our study. In Jesus' name, amen.